Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Oh, that's starting to sound good. Let's try that again just for me. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Oh, I love it. Welcome to Cleveland United Methodist Church. I'm Jamie Hudgens. I'm the pastor here, and I was telling some of the folks earlier, as we're moving back towards normal, I'm trying to do that as well. One of the things I've been sharing with folks this morning is I was trying to look more pastoral this morning. That's why I put on my sport coat. But one of the things I realized, I don't know where my clothes are. So I know I packed them up and I moved them home from Reinhardt, but I don't know where they are. So anyway, we'll get there, right? Excited to tell you that White County has been in the yellow for over a week now. When I checked the numbers yesterday, that's a good thing. Praise God. We were 4.3 yesterday as the risk level, as opposed to over 100 at the peak for us. So we're moving in the right direction. So as such, we had a meeting with the trustees and we're talking about beginning to relax our closing. And so that's part of why you see there is no wonderful yellow tape all through the sanctuary. We want to continue to encourage people to be cautious and distance as much as possible, but realizing that things are beginning to relax and breathe. So we're excited about that. I don't know if you know it, but next Sunday is Palm Sunday, and then the Sunday after that is Easter. We're going to be able to worship together for those events, but because of the pandemic and stuff, we have not planned any Holy Week services this year. So we're not totally back to normal, but we're moving in that direction. But we look forward to seeing you and your families and friends and guests next Sunday and the Sunday after that. And so let's be preparing for that as we who are regular gatherers here begin to look for people who are our guests over the next few weeks and make sure we make them feel welcome, right? So as we gather today to worship God, and we gather anticipating the coming of the Lord in his second appearance, we gather today knowing that he came and he sacrificed himself for us. So today we're here to worship God. I'm glad you're here. And as we gather for this moment, I invite you to join me in prayer. Lord, as we gather in this place this morning, we thank you for the grace that you've extended us. And in this moment, we invite you into this place that we might worship you. Lord, hear our worship. Receive it. May it be something that glorifies you and makes you smile. Lord, we offer you this, our worship today. We pray these things in the strong and precious name of your Son, Jesus, who gave us everything we needed. It's in his name we pray, and all God's children said.
Amen.
Now, I invite you to stand as you are able and join us for the opening hymn, number 110, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God.
We will sing the first and last verse.
Thank you. morning.
Good morning.
As we enter our time of cares and concerns this morning, I want to lift up Claire Phillips. Claire is experiencing some frequent times of confusion, and her physical health is failing. Also, her daughter Linda is her caregiver. Let's lift her up in prayer that God will give her countenance and give her support. Also, Nancy Phillips, one of our members, fell 2 weeks ago at CBS and had sustained some lacerations to her face and has been recovering at home. So we pray for her well-being. Nancy Patchell, excuse me. I'm so sorry. I wrote that down wrong. Thank you. So it shows we're in an imperfect world. Are there others? So sorry, Sandy. Yes, we will. Thank you for that. Are there others? Glad to hear Tim's doing good. That's a prayer answer. Also, I wanted to give you an update on Emmett's services. They've been tentatively scheduled for May the 1st here at the church at 2 p.m. So join us if you can for that. And please keep Martha, again, keep her lifted up in your prayers as she goes through this process of planning and just adjusting to things.
You said May the 1st?
May the 1st, that's correct. And it'll be here. And be here at the church. If you would bow silently with me, please. Most kind and gracious God, we come to you today with thankful hearts, thankful for your mercy, thankful for your grace and your never-ending love. Come to you today also with request. You told us to bring these things to you and lay them at your feet. Father, we lift up Claire to you today, Claire Phillips. We ask that you just give her guidance, that you would instill in her a reasoning, that you would help her, that you would watch over her and protect her during these times that she just doesn't understand. Father, we know that you do. We also pray for Linda as she meets the challenges of being a caregiver. Father, we know that you and only you can handle some of these situations. We lift up Nancy Paschal to you today. We pray that you just heal her body, that you would just give her comfort, give her strength, and renew her. Father, we lift up Sonia Brand to you today. Father, we know that only you can intercede, and we ask that you do so. We know that through you all things are possible, and I pray that you just lay your hand upon her today, your healing hand. Father, I just ask that you continue to support us in this virus, that you just continue to watch this and do what we've watched you do. You've kept your promises. You've handled this, and we thank you for that. Father, even though our fears are somewhat allayed, we're still conscious of these things. We thank you for that as well. We know through you that anything can be conquered. There's nothing in this world that you can't handle. And we find comfort in that today. We find peace in that today. And we thank you for that today. Father, give us the passion to serve. Give us the passion to love one another, both inside this building and outside these walls. Help us to be the church wherever we may go. And Father, help us remember the words that Jesus, your Son, taught the disciples when he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory.
Thank you.
Said it before, and I'll probably say it again. It's a blessing to be in a place where we have such talented folks sharing in worship. And that would be a good point for you to say amen.
Amen.
Did that kind of prompt that? I know you agree with me. You just didn't say it, right? I'll just offer a subtle reminder. Well, it's exciting to gather in this place, and I'm thrilled as we're moving back towards some sense of normalcy. But it makes it all the more interesting for me as I'm still trying to find what we are together. This is still new to me. And so moving back, I spent 3 years in campus ministry and moving back into local parish ministry. It's interesting. And doing that in the midst of a pandemic has proved even more interesting. But I'm excited to be here today, and as we're moving toward our Holy Week, next week starts with Palm Sunday, and we're not going to be able to do that the way we normally would, but we're trying to figure out ways that we can be appropriate and do everything we need to do there. But today, it's interesting. The passage that was presented for today through the lectionary is actually past Palm Sunday in context. In John's Gospel, this passage comes after the triumphal entry. So this is during Holy Week, what we're going to look at today. And it's an experience and some teaching that came out of that. So keep that in mind as we're going through our conversation today. Now, as we approach this, I really hope that you've had one of those moments in life, one of those kind of aha moments where you've experienced something and think, this is why I was put on this earth. For me, one of those experiences came as a young kid, was water skiing. I used to love getting out on the lake, and it just made me feel so invigorated. Our family was big on water. Water skied my whole life. My dad water skied up until he was in his mid-late 80s, or 70s, excuse me, and was a barefooter. And so all of our family, I'm a barefooter, and that, if you don't know what that is, that's the particular challenge of trying to ski without skis. So it's a little bit faster thing. My dad decided after he got in his mid-late 70s that probably that was not a good idea, because you're going about 39, 40 miles an hour across the water, and at that speed, even water feels pretty hard when you hit it. So that was part of our experience, and that was what gave me fire. And because of that, you know, I love boats too. So a lot of things about water. Later in life, I became exposed to youth ministry and sowing into the lives of teenagers and helping them come to receive that saving grace of Jesus Christ always gives me that, wow, this is what it's all about kind of feeling. I also have that reaction when I have the opportunity to lead in worship experiences where people are moved and engaged in worshiping God. That knowing what you were created for, that revelation is huge, and it's where we ultimately find our sense of purpose in life. Today we're going to look at a passage in the Gospel of John. And if you want to be turning there in your Bibles, it's the third in the Gospels in the New Testament, and that's kind of the second half of the Bible. I still do that, I'm sorry. I'm sure that most of y'all have spent your life in the Bible and know those kind of things, but in several of the situations I've been, we were inviting people into Scripture that had not spent much time there, so a little information is often helpful. But we're going to be looking at that, and in particular, we're going to look at the 12th chapter, where we see or hear Jesus has found his purpose to be. That this is why I'm here statement. Now, this what we're talking about is a public revelation of that. In this moment, as we're talking about, this is again Holy Week,
Jesus is probably in the temple. They don't give those specifics about it, but probably in the temple and sharing this with the people that are there. Now, we don't generally think of purpose as being something that is hard or painful, but for Jesus, his purpose actually brings about his human death. Much like Atlas's purpose, if you know that mythology, his purpose was to hold up the celestial heavens, a life of sacrifice and struggle. Jesus' purpose was one of self-sacrifice and death. And that for the sake of all creation, which includes you and me. I invite you to hear these words from the 12th chapter of the Gospel according to John, beginning with the 20th verse. Now there were some Greeks among those who went up to worship at the festival. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and with a request. "Sir," they said, "we would like to see Jesus." Philip went to tell Andrew. Andrew and Philip, in turn, told Jesus. Jesus replied, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces seeds. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice from heaven, "I have glorified it and will glorify it again." The crowd that was there heard it and said it had thundered. Others said an angel had spoken to him. Jesus said, "This voice was for your benefit, not mine. Now is the time for judgment in this world. Now is the prince of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to show the kind of death he was going to die. The crowd spoke up, "We've heard from the law that the Messiah will remain forever. So how can you say the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man?" Then Jesus told them, "You're going to have the light just a little while longer. Walk while you have the light before darkness overtakes you. Whoever walks in the dark does not know where they're going. Believe in the light while you have the light, so that you may become children of the light." When he had finished speaking, Jesus left and hid himself from them. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Won't you pray with me? Lord, may the words that come out of my mouth and the things that all of us are thinking about in these next few moments, may they bring a smile to your face. We pray these things in the strong and precious name of your Son, Jesus, and all God's children say.
Amen.
Well, I want to offer you some observations about this passage. And this is not maybe what would be considered a normal service sermon, but I just want to share some of the things that I saw as I read this passage and then kind of pull it together, hopefully, at the end. So, it'll be interesting to see what you think. Maybe you can't figure out what I'm doing here, but I'm trusting that God has a plan and will pull all this together in your minds and hearts and help us grow from this. So I want to start out with some observations about verse 20 through 22. And as you look at this, I think it's significant to notice that in this passage, it's some Gentiles that are wanting to see Jesus. So they're gathered in the temple, and there's some Gentiles, these folks from Greece, and they were there in their midst. And so this is kind of the opening, as we see this in the midst of Holy Week, the opening of the gospel being presented not only to the Jews, but also to all of creation. And then we see in verse 23, we see this. Jesus replied, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified." Now, a little observation about that. I hope you understand that
the word glorify, that's not something we use a lot now. I think your generation, a lot of y'all sitting in the room, had heard that word growing up and it was used more frequently, but we don't use that term now in common language, do we? But so I want you to understand that glorified in this passage equals being lifted up. Right? And lifted up in this passage also connects with the sacrifice, right? Because we're talking about, in terms of Jesus, being lifted up on the cross. So we're looking at Jesus' glorification comes through his death and resurrection. Now, moving on to verse 24, let me just read this passage for you again, verses 24 through 26. Very truly I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. In these passages, we begin to see Jesus trying to help people understand the meaning of his death. He's still kind of, he's much more clear in his conversation about his death, but he's still kind of veiled a little bit. But he's trying to help people see what's going to happen. And so this idea of the seed falling, and if it does not fall and get lodged into the dirt, then that seed simply dies. And most of y'all have witnessed that in something you've ate, eaten, maybe tomatoes, you see the seeds. And maybe some of you, how many of y'all don't like to eat the seeds in tomatoes? A few of you. So if you just leave those seeds out, they die. But this is one of the things I've gotten to witness in the last few years. My parents compost. And so as I take stuff out to the compost pile, eventually I have all kind of different things growing up in that compost pile, right? And so we've had tomato plants, we've had avocados, we had all kinds of stuff. But unless that seed falls and is planted, unless that seed dies like that, it can't produce anything. And so it's incredibly important in this moment to understand the crucifixion in terms of all of these things. That while this was a sacrifice, it was also critical for our resurrection, for our life. And so these verses are offering that to us, some meaning to that. In verse 24, that death of the one brings life or salvation to many, to all of us. Metaphorically, the statement of what Jesus says specifically in verse 32, and I will draw all people to myself. When Jesus is lifted up, he brings salvation, eternal life for all of us. In verse 25, most attested saying of Jesus. And let me just read that again for you. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. That's one of the things that I've seen is that is a statement that Jesus said more than once, right? If you want to gain your life, you have to surrender your life. If you surrender your life here on this earth, then you gain eternal life. Now, so there's a couple things in there. First, that idea of sacrificing your life is something that is through the Gospels. We see it in several different places in the Gospels. I'll just give you the references. Matthew 10:39, Matthew 16:25, Mark 10:39, Luke 9:24, and Luke 17:33. All of these passages have that thought. And not only more in places of the Gospel of John, we see, some of y'all will remember the passage John 15:13. Right? If I lay down my life for a friend, that's a sign of love. Well, Peter said he'd lay down his life for Jesus several times as well. Most notably, as we're approaching that crucifixion scene, right? Peter said, no, I'll die with you. And that's when Jesus tells him, no, your death will be much different. So we move on. There's this kind of combination of verses that begin to speak about the urgency of this situation. So verse 27 says this, now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. No, it was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. So in this passage we see there's no hesitation in Jesus to pursue the path that's laid out for him, right? His purpose in him being in the temple on earth in that moment was moving toward this moment, this sacrifice. And there was no hesitation in his thought as to what he should do. And then picking up in 28, then a voice came from heaven, I have glorified it and will glorify it again. And then verse 29, the crowd that was there and heard it said it had thundered. Others said an angel has spoken. Well, this is all helping us understand the urgency of this moment as the Gospels record it. Jesus is moving into a position to make this ultimate sacrifice for you and for me and for all mankind. And then verse 32 says this, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. Well, this is an interesting passage. And it kind of, we talked, I think it was last week, we were talking about John 3:14, that makes a reference back to the Old Testament, to Moses in the desert, and the snake being lifted up on the stick as offering salvation. And then making that connection to Jesus being lifted up on a tree, offering salvation to the world. And so there's that connection. And then there's also some dual meaning going on in this passage. There's a physical lifting up connected to the cross, right? That Jesus would be physically lifted up on this cross as part of our salvation. But then there's also this concept of exalting or lifting up God, lifting up the name of Jesus, lifting up Jesus. And so there's all these kind of things going on. And then concluding all of it, we move into these two passages in verses 35 and 36. Let me read them again to you because it kind of shifts gears into this light and dark mode that we talked about a little bit last week as well. Verse 35, then Jesus told them, you're going to have the light just a little while longer. Walk while you have this light before darkness overtakes you. Whoever walks in the dark does not know where they're going. Listen to that. Whoever walks in the dark does not know where they're going. Believe in the light while you have the light, so that you may become children of the light. This idea of light and darkness is still prevalent in this world. And in that moment in the temple, he was talking to people in whom he was standing in front of and trying to tell them, you need to understand this. You'll have the light, me, with you for just a moment. You need to prepare yourself to be able to walk, not only walk in darkness, but be the light so that you can walk. Have the light in you. So this light and darkness, and it reaffirms the concept of judgment that we need to understand as Christians, as believers. That in this world in which we live, there is this thing called sin that separates us from God. And in those moments, as you transition from this life into the next life, there will be judgment. And there will be judgment as to whether you enter eternal life in the presence of God or into eternal life in the absence of God. And then there's this notion of believe in the light while you have the light, so that you may become children of light. Now, have you ever watched a little child? Children are fun, right? There's energy in children. We had one of my cousins was one, and our whole family, there are four boys on my side of the family. My mother's sister had four boys. And so when we get together for family gatherings, and it was kind of an interesting terrace of things, my oldest brother was the oldest one. It came down to me. My oldest cousin was 4 months older than me, and then me, and then all of their brothers were down below. So we had them going for a long way. But when we get together, man, it was energy. And one of my cousins had the greatest expression of childhood that there is. He would go and go and go, and wherever he was, when the energy ran, it didn't matter what was going on. When he was done, he was done. He'd be asleep beside the dinner table, wherever we were, he'd just go to sleep. But that sense of a childlikeness that emanates whatever it has, right? Children love to share what they have. Sometimes that's a good thing. Sometimes it's other stuff. I I mean, if you've seen the thing where a child sneezes in their hand, Children love to share what they have. And as children of the light, we need to want to share what we have. And I told you last week about the darkness and the light in the cave. And even a little matchlight in the midst of a totally dark cave floods the room with light. And that's what we're called to do. That's part of our purpose. Well, the other thing that we see in this last little bit I want to share with you is that there's this sense of atonement that we're seeing woven through Jesus' conversation here. If you look at this whole passage, it's developing this crucial concept of atonement. And I don't know what you know about atonement. One of the comical ways that I was taught in seminary to understand the term and the notion of atonement was at one minute. We are made one with God again by this Christ. And there's kind of three senses of atonement that we need to be aware of. One, there's a sense of a ransom, that we're caught captive in something, and there's a ransom that has to be paid to get us out of this state into this other state, right? And we think about that. And then there's a sense of sacrifice. And if you study Jewish history, you understand Old Testament law. And Old Testament law was a thing of sin and penance. There was sacrifice that had to be made to pay the price for the sin that was committed. And so there's this sense of sacrifice, and we see this displayed vividly in the crucifixion. And then this atonement, there's this sense of moral influence or a model of moral behavior. And Jesus certainly gives us that in his life, but not only in his life, but in the way he died, the way he offered himself. He lived out the passage, "Greater love has no one than this, that they lay down their life for their friends." And so there's that sense. And all of this that we're talking about is in the concept of creating the church, building this community. That's what's the result of all of what Jesus did, or the fruit of Jesus' life. Well, let me try to kind of pull this all together here. I know I've thrown a bunch of stuff at you, but there's a point to all of this. This is what Jesus came to earth for. The whole impact of the incarnation, of Jesus being born as one of us, is both to establish the restored relationship with God, our restored relationship with God, the creation's restored relationship with God, and to establish the community of believers. It's all about relationship. Everything that the scripture is about relationship. First, it's the model of Jesus' relationship with God that he offers us. And if you see, there's oftentimes in the midst of all the things that are going on, Jesus would withdraw from everything that was going on and spend time in communion with his Father. And that's the model that we're supposed to follow. And there's also the model that it was complete submission. There was never a moment where Jesus attempted to deviate from God's plan and God's direction. Always surrendered to God's will. That complete submission. And then there's this example of Jesus' relationship with humans, with the disciples, with the creation that was around him. And that's part of the example, how Jesus related with all those people. And then finally, it's about this relationship that we have with each other and with the world in which we live. So we continue this notion of being children of light. That we continue to be light in a world in which light is fading. And it feels to me, as I watch a lot of things, it's often difficult to maintain a positive attitude when I see a lot of the things that are going on in the world around me. When I see the degradation of spiritual influence in all kind of different venues, right? It's challenging. But that is why Jesus came. to offer the world salvation through his gift of sacrifice, of ransom. And this is why you are here, that you can be light in the dark world. That's the challenge as we prepare for Holy Week, as we prepare for Palm Sunday. I invite you to go into a world that is darkening as we speak and be light. Be children of light. That's why you're here. Won't you pray with me? God, in this moment, we know that there are things going on that are not your will. So we come before you, Lord, knowing that the light of Jesus is only here as we offer it. Help us, Lord, as we understand these different relationships, our relationships with you and our relationships with each other and our relationships with the world in which we live, that your desire, your plan, our purpose is to be children of the light, that we be light in the dark world. Father, help us to offer ourselves to you that you may shine brightly through us. As we lift you up, you might draw all people to you. We pray these strength things in the strong and precious name of your Son, Jesus, and all God's children said.
Amen.
Well, we're not quite there yet, but we're moving toward it. But as we press on in these moments, we do our offering a little differently. And so there's a basket down by the front door as you came in, and we invite you to leave your offering there. But as part of that, we want to celebrate that. And so I invite you to pray with me as we thank God for these gifts, and we ask that God would bless them. Won't you pray with me? God, as we offer these gifts to you, we pray that you would receive them, that you would bless them, that you would use them through us, that we might be light in the community and in the world in which we live. Who receive these our gifts, we pray this in the strong and precious name of your Son, Jesus. And again, all God's children said,
Amen.
Now I invite you to stand as you are able and join with us in the singing of the doxology.
Survey the wondrous cross.
Oh,
I invite you to go from this place into a world that desperately needs to know the love of Christ and be children of the light. May God use you and bless you in ways you can't even imagine. Have a great week.